Welcome to this channel, Gain Java Knowledge. And today in this video, we are going to learn what is reactive programming and why we need to use reactive programming and when we use. So first we will discuss what is reactive programming. What is reactive programming? In plain terms, we can say reactive programming is about non-blocking applications that are asynchronous and event driven and require a small number of threads. So we will discuss each and everything, like what is asynchronous and what is event driven and how it use threads. So everything we will discuss further. And the next is a key aspect of reactive application is the concept of web pressure that is not supported by our traditional APIs. So this concept was introduced in reactive programming. So it supports back pressure supports also. So these are the main features of reactive programming, that is asynchronous and non-blocking. Second is it supports functional style code, and it also supports data flow as event driven stream, and it also supports back pressure on data streams. Now we will discuss one by one what is asynchronous and non-blocking. First we will discuss. In our traditional API, we use Spring Web MVC, that is Spring MVC. So it uses servlet stack, and now the Spring Web Flux is reactive stack. So it is synchronous and blocking type of request, and this is asynchronous and non-blocking web framework. So first we will read. Spring MVC is built on the servlet API and uses a synchronous blocking input output architecture with a one request per thread model. So it slows down the performance of our application. But with the reactive stack, Spring WebFlux is a non-blocking web framework built from the group up to take advantage of multi-core next generation processor and handle massive numbers of concurrent corrections. And in reactive programming, and by using Spring WebFlux, it supports Netty Servlet 3.1 plus containers. But for Spring MVC, we used Servlet containers, and it provides support by Servlet API, and it provides support to reactive stream adapters. And for reactive programming, we need to use Spring WebFlux, or for Servlet stack, we need to use Spring MVC. And Spring MVC supports this repository, that is JDBC, JPA, NoSQL. And reactive programming, by using Spring WebFlux framework, it supports Mongo, Cassandra, Redis, and Couchbase R2DB C database. So now we will discuss what is synchronous and blocking, and what is asynchronous and non-blocking type of request. So in our traditional API, that we are using Spring MVC, it supports synchronous and blocking request type. So first the request comes from our client, and this request goes to our embedded Tomcat server. And here we are using thread pool, and inside thread pool we can manage here limit of threads. So once the first request will come, so it will provide assigned to the first thread, and then thread will goes to our database, and until it will not receive the data from database, this thread will be in the waiting state. Like this we can see it will be in the waiting state until it receive the data from DB, and when it accept receive the data from DB, then it will return back response to thread 1. Then second request will come, and it will goes to thread 2, and it will also wait until DB return the response back to thread 2. So thread 2 will be in the waiting state until it receive the response from DB. Like this, if we have thread pool and its size is limited, like we have only 20 threads, so concurrently we can only send 20 requests simultaneously. We can, if we are going to send 25 requests simultaneously, then our 5 requests will be in the waiting state, and they will wait until more 5 threads will be free, then these 5 more requests will be executed. So it is mainly degrade the performance of our application, and so reactive programming came into picture to improve the performance of our application. So reactive programming supports like asynchronous and non-blocking. So here we saw that it's following the thread per request model. For each request it goes to one thread, for second request goes to second thread. But if we are using asynchronous and non-blocking architecture, that is by provided by reactive programming, here we have also limited size of thread pool, but these are not following the request per thread model architecture. Now let's understand how it works. So now I will send the request to our application, and this request will be assigned to thread 1, and then thread 1 will be go to database and fetch the data from DB. But before going to DB, it will go through event loop also. So event loop mainly contains three methods, that are onNext, onComplete and onError, that we will discuss in depth in next videos. So this event loop will accept the request from thread loop and send the request to DB. So the advantage of this event pool is that where we will not wait to get response back. So instead we will send an event to database and inform to database that I am not waiting for anymore. So when you just complete your job and ready with your response, then assign response back to available threads. Any thread he can return back response. So in this case, not only my single thread is blocking, and we can process n number of requests simultaneously with only limited size of thread pool. So we can say asynchronous and non-blocking. The reactive programming is a new paradigm of programming which has been designed to handle the massive load with a less number of threads, keeping an asynchronous non-blocking data flow in mind. And the next feature is functional style code. And functional style code means it is similar to Java 8 Stream API and easy to work with Lambda. And Mono and Flux are the return types for reactive programming. Mono is used when we are getting only single record from DB or no record. But if we are getting lots of record, then we can provide Flux as the return type for reactive programming. So it will handle 0 to n number of records, and Flux Mono is mainly used to handle 0 or 1 record. That we will discuss furthermore in next videos, and we'll execute the code and show how it works. And the third feature is data flow as event driven stream. So data flow as event driven stream, it mainly supports three methods, means these are three events. First in on next event, second is on error, and third is on complete event. And one event or message for a every result item from data source. For example, if we are getting 100 records from DB, then there are hundreds event will be executed. Here we can see if we are going to get all items from database, then if there are n number of records, then there are n number of event will be executed. First on next it will get first record, second on next will get second record, and if there are 100 records, then the 100th on next will get 100th number of records. And if there are no error while getting record from DB and everything is executed smoothly, then the next event is on complete will be executed, and we will return response back to our API. So this was the happy path scenario. If there is an error while getting record from DB, for example, after getting first record from DB, if we are performing our business logic on that and in the second it's throwing an error, then this next event will not execute and on complete will also not execute. At this place, on error event is one more event that will execute. So if error is coming due to our code, then on error event will be executed. So there are, we can see three events: on next, on error, on complete. So we will exploring these all things in future videos that will be upcoming. And the next feature is back pressure on data streams. In our traditional API that we are created by using Spring MVC does not support back pressure. We are using Spring MVC approach and we are going to get all items from DB, and there are lakhs of record. So sometime there may be chance application may not be able to handle huge records from DB, and there may be chance application may crash with out of memory if there are lakhs of or crores of records in DB. So to resolve these type of activities, back pressure was introduced in reactive programming. So how it helps to resolve this issue? So then our application sent the request to database to handle this type of request. Then our application may request to DB, you are sending too much data and I am not able to handle it, so please slow down this process. And in our traditional API, there is no way that application can communicate with the database and request to slow down the process of sending data. So in our traditional API, there is no back pressure compatibility, but in reactive programming, there is back pressure compatibility available. So here our data source may be any other REST API or any file or database is there. So if data source is producing more data than we are expecting, then there is a way to provide a feedback by application to data source. You need to slow down the process. So like this, we can handle these type of issues. To provide support to reactive programming, we will use Spring Webflux module that was introduced by Spring Framework in Spring 5. So what is Spring Webflux module? Spring Webflux module has been introduced as part of Spring 5, and with this it started to support reactive programming. So it uses an asynchronous programming model. The use of reactive programming makes application highly scalable to support high request load over a period of time. So in our next video, we will create one example for this reactive programming by using Spring Boot Webflux. For this, we just need to add one Spring Webflux starter dependency in our Maven. So let's see in the next video. Okay, thanks for watching this video.